Welcome to the eighth session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on cardiovascular disease. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write them. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. Today's sessions will be presented by Dr. Latha Palaniappan and Ms. Ariel Holland. And now for the presentation.
Good afternoon. My name is Ariel Holland. Thank you all for attending today. I'd like to thank the Stanford Geriatric Education Center for inviting us to present on this webinar topic. Again, we have no conflicts of interest to report. We have three learning objectives today. One, to identify differences in cardiovascular disease, morbidity, and mortality among diverse elders. Second, to identify risk factors that explain racial ethnic disparities in CVD. And third, to identify CVD treatment and care recommendations with a focus on potential differences. I will be going over the first two objectives, and then I'll transfer the presentation over to Latha. Many of you are here today because you care for diverse elders and know how important the healthcare needs are for this population. I'd like to briefly highlight that the growing need for care of diverse elders is going to increase over the next couple of decades. We can see that the projected percentage change in the U.S. populations for individuals ages 60 and over from 2010 to 2050, we'll see the largest increases for the Asian American and Hispanic Latino groups, which I've highlighted here. Again, it is important to acknowledge that there is a growing need for care in these diverse populations. Before we get started today, I'd like to mention some of the limitations of research conducted in racial ethnic minorities. Our presentation will provide an overview of cardiovascular disease care in diverse elders, but there are some restrictions of this presentation. Most of the research has been conducted in blacks or African Americans and Mexican Americans. There are about 300 million Americans in the U.S., and there are about 38 million blacks or African Americans. Mexican Americans comprise about 63% of the total number of Hispanics in the U.S., so about 32 million out of 51 million. The other racial ethnic minorities are less well studied in the research. Secondly, I'd like to acknowledge that there is a great deal of heterogeneity in demographic, cultural, and CVD risk factors within the broader racial ethnic categories. So for example, Asian Indians are very different compared to looking at Asian Americans as a group. Lastly, I'd like to highlight that most national data is self-report, and studies have shown that this self-report data may underestimate CVD and risk factor prevalence, particularly for racial ethnic minorities. This underestimation is due to health literacy and language barriers. As we continue with this presentation, I'd ask you to keep these limitations in mind as we go through some of the findings. Cardiovascular disease encompasses a spectrum of diseases, including coronary heart disease, which I'll refer to as CHD, stroke, peripheral arterial disease, which I'll refer to as PAD, congestive heart failure, which I'll refer to as CHF, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. Although we've included these under the cardiovascular disease definition, in our presentation, we will refer to hypertension and dyslipidemia as cardiovascular disease risk factors. Vital statistics data show that heart disease is the leading cause of death for persons over the age of 65, irrespective of sex, race, or Hispanic origin. I would like to point out that Asians and Pacific Islanders were grouped together, which may mask differences between these groups. This data also showed that stroke was the third leading cause behind cancer for all groups, irrespective of sex, race, or Hispanic origin. Again, highlighting the importance of cardiovascular disease care in diverse elder populations. In this presentation, we will be reviewing the unique CVD risks for each racial ethnic group as compared to non-Hispanic whites. I'll begin with examining the data for blacks or African Americans. There are about 5 million blacks or African Americans over the age of 60 in the U.S. While I won't read every bullet point on these slides, I'll take some time to highlight some important findings. Blacks or African Americans have higher prevalence rates of stroke, CHF, and PAD compared to non-Hispanic whites. In this next slide, I'll highlight the higher first-time stroke risk for blacks or African Americans compared to non-Hispanic whites. If you look at the horizontal axis, we're showing the risk of first-time stroke. On the left, you can see the decreased risk compared to non-Hispanic whites. As we move towards the middle at 1, you'll see equal risk compared to non-Hispanic whites. And as we move towards the right, you'll see increased risk of first-time stroke compared to non-Hispanic whites. On the vertical axis, we have the different age groups, starting from youngest at the bottom, going to oldest at the top. This red rectangle highlights the greatest risk of first-time stroke for blacks or African Americans in the youngest age group, 35 to 44. There are two points to make in this slide. First, one way to improve care for diverse elders is to screen early for stroke, as the risk of first-time stroke is the greatest at the youngest age groups. Another point to make is that even though we see that the risk of first-time stroke is almost comparable to non-Hispanic whites for those ages 75 to 84, this figure does not show the risk of second-time stroke for blacks or African Americans. We know that a history of stroke leads to a greater risk of having another stroke compared to those who have never had a stroke. And as a healthcare provider, it is important to obtain disease history. This next slide highlights that blacks or African Americans have higher CHD mortality than other racial ethnic groups. On the vertical axis, we're showing the CHD mortality rate per 100,000 U.S. standard population. Using vital statistics data, researchers have demonstrated that CHD mortality rates are higher for blacks or African Americans between the ages for those greater than 45 years of age. We have chosen to highlight the 75 to 84 age group, and I would like to point out that there is a small typo. So even at the oldest age groups, blacks or African Americans still have higher rates of CHD mortality compared to other racial ethnic groups. The Hispanic population is one of the better studied racial ethnic minority groups. There are about 4.2 million Hispanic Americans over the age of 60 in the U.S. And similar to blacks or African Americans, they also have higher stroke incidence and prevalence rates compared to non-Hispanic whites. Hispanic Americans with self-reported CHD are more likely to report fair or poor health compared to non-Hispanic whites. And Hispanics with PAD are more likely to undergo amputation compared to non-Hispanic whites. Lower SES, or socioeconomic status, is associated with CVD and all-cause mortality. Hispanics have lower socioeconomic status and higher rates of other CVD risk factors. Therefore, we would expect to see higher rates of CVD mortality and all-cause mortality compared to non-Hispanic whites. However, we actually see lower mortality rates due to CVD and all causes compared to non-Hispanic whites. Mortality rates are calculated by dividing the number of deaths, which we gather from death certificates, by the entire population that self-identifies as that racial ethnic group, which we gain from census data. We have a very good idea of how many Hispanics are living in the U.S., which we gather from the census forms, where people indicate their racial ethnic group. However, on death certificates, race ethnicity is often determined by the coroner or medical examiner, who may not have information from the family. Some researchers have pointed to the fact that Hispanic deaths may be underreported as they are misclassified as non-Hispanic white on the death certificates. Other explanations for why we see lower rates of CVD and all-cause mortality in Hispanics compared to non-Hispanic whites are the stamina hypothesis, which states that when Hispanics are sick, they return to their country of origin to die and be with their family and relatives. Because we don't have death certificates for these people, they are not captured in mortality estimates. The healthy migrant effect states that migrants are somehow healthier than those who remain in the country of origin. You may wonder why they have more CVD risk factors if they are healthier, and some argue that they are healthy because they can live with these risk factors and not die. The reason I bring up the Hispanic paradox is that it's important to acknowledge that these methods and hypotheses are not adequate to explain this paradox. There may be biological reasons why there are lower mortality rates, or there may be alternative explanations as to why these deaths are not being accurately captured. In conclusion, we don't have the whole story. And again, it's important to consider findings in the context of these limitations. Contrary to Hispanic Americans and blacks or African Americans, Asians are generally thought to have a lower risk of CVD compared to non-Hispanic whites. However, when we examine Asian subgroups separately, so for instance looking at Asian Indians compared to Chinese, we find great heterogeneity in CVD risk among these subgroups. In this next slide, I'll highlight the heterogeneity that we see among the subgroups compared to non-Hispanic whites. Similar to a previous figure, you'll see that on the horizontal axis, we have the odds of CHD compared to non-Hispanic whites. As we move towards the left, we see decreased odds of CHD compared to non-Hispanic whites. As we move towards the middle, towards 1, we see equal odds of CHD compared to non-Hispanic whites. And as we move toward the right, we see increased odds of CHD compared to non-Hispanic whites. The green bars highlight decreased odds of CHD, which we see for Chinese women and Chinese men. The red boxes highlight increased odds of CHD, which we see for Filipino women and Filipino men, as well as Asian Indian men, compared to non-Hispanic whites. Another understudied group are the American Indians and Alaska Natives. There are about 360,000 American Indians or Alaska Natives over the age of 60 living in the U.S. One of the first studies to provide a description of cardiovascular disease and its risk factors among American Indians was the Strong Heart Study, which showed that almost a quarter of American Indian men and women ages 45 to 74 had some evidence of heart disease. Similar to Hispanics and blacks or African Americans, stroke incidence and prevalence are also higher among American Indians or Alaska Natives. Most national data group American Indians and Alaska Natives together. which may mask some of the heterogeneity that we see among these two groups. Another group that was not studied separately until recently is the Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islander population. Until 2000, Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders were grouped with Asian Americans in studies of race and ethnicity. And in some studies, this is still the case. There are currently about 60,000 Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders over the age of 60 living in the U.S., and national data for these populations is scarce, with the largest populations living in Hawaii and California. Hawaii vital statistics data do show, however, that Native Hawaiians have the highest CHD mortality rates compared to other racial ethnic groups, and they have the second highest stroke mortality behind Filipinos compared to other racial ethnic groups. Now that we have described the unique CVD risk for racial ethnic minorities, we will now examine some of the CVD risk factors that may explain some of these CVD disparities. Racial ethnic minorities have greater prevalence rates of major CVD risk factors, including biological risk factors, such as hypertension, dyslipidemia, BMI, and diabetes, behavioral risk factors, including smoking, physical activity, inactivity, and poor diet, as well as socioeconomic risk factors, such as education, poverty, and social connections. The prevalence of greater than two self-reported risk factors was the highest among racial ethnic minorities, according to the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance Survey. I'd like to point out that Asian Americans were not included in this survey, mainly due to undersampling of these populations, again, highlighting some of the limitations of research among these groups. CVD awareness is an important part of improving primary and secondary prevention of CVD outcomes. According to National Telephone Survey, Blacks or African Americans and Hispanics have lower awareness of CHD stroke and PAD signs and symptoms compared to non-Hispanic whites. Community-based studies have also demonstrated low awareness of heart disease and stroke signs and symptoms among Chinese, Korean, and Vietnamese participants. There's an important opportunity for the healthcare provider to improve understanding of heart disease, stroke, and PAD risk factor and symptoms among diverse elders. Hypertension is a major risk factor for CVD, particularly for stroke. Latha will address treatment recommendations for hypertension in diverse elders later on in this presentation. I'd like to point out that higher rates of hypertension have been found for Blacks or African Americans, American Indians and Alaska Natives, Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders, and Filipinos compared to non-Hispanic whites. Severity and control of hypertension is also worse in Blacks or African Americans. Dyslipidemia is an important risk factor, biological risk factor for CVD, especially for CHD. Racial ethnic minorities are more likely to have fewer cholesterol screenings, less likely to take their medications, and to achieve lipid goals compared to non-Hispanic whites. Again, Latha will address treatment recommendations for dyslipidemia in diverse elders later on. Higher prevalence rates of dyslipidemia have also been found for Mexican Americans, American Indians, Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders, and Asian Indians compared to non-Hispanic whites. Obesity and diabetes are important biological risk factors for CVD. The relative risk for CVD increases by about 20% in men and women among those who are overweight and by about 46% in men and 64% in women who are obese. Those with diabetes are about twice as likely to develop CVD. We see that Black or African American and Mexican American women are more likely to be obese compared to non-Hispanic white women. And the prevalence of diabetes is greater for Blacks or African Americans and Mexican Americans compared to non-Hispanic whites. Higher rates of diabetes have also been found for Asian Americans at lower BMI values. Socioeconomic risk factors are very important for CVD development as well. These include poverty, education, and social connections. Studies have shown that older blacks or African Americans, Hispanics, and Asian men were more likely to live in poverty, less likely to graduate from high school or college than non-Hispanic whites. And while Asians have higher education levels on average, studies have shown that about 13% of Asian American elders possess no formal education compared to about 1% and 6% of the nation's non-Hispanic white and black or African American population. Studies have demonstrated the power of social connections on heart disease mortality. This slide demonstrates the varying living arrangements for adults ages 65 and older by racial ethnic group. We can see that the blue bar indicates living with a spouse, the red living with relatives, the green living with non-relatives, and the purple living alone. We can see the different racial ethnic groups in the different columns with white, blacks, or African Americans, Asians, and then Hispanic. These red circles highlight that black or African American men and women are more likely to live alone. As a healthcare provider, it may be important for one to ask about living arrangements and different social outlets in order to improve upon the social environment. Smoking, physical activity, and diet are important behavioral risk factors for CVD. High prevalence rates of smoking have been found for American Indians, Alaska Natives, and Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders compared to non-Hispanic whites. Blacks or African Americans and Hispanics are less likely to be asked about their smoking habits or offered cessation interventions. Blacks or African Americans and Hispanics, Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islanders, and American Indians all report lower levels of physical activity compared to non-Hispanic whites. African Americans and American Indians or Alaska Natives had worse overall scores on the USDA Healthy Eating Index compared to non-Hispanic whites. The Healthy Eating Index is a composite score measuring compliance with the 2005 Dietary Guidelines for Americans. In separate studies, they have found that highly acculturated Hispanics and Chinese report fewer servings of fruits and vegetables per day compared with those not highly acculturated, and acculturated meaning more westernized culture. This final slide provides a summary of self-reported health indicators for those 65 years and older by different racial ethnic group. Again, we see that blacks or African Americans and Hispanics have higher rates of hypertension and diabetes, and they are less likely to report physical activity and healthy weight compared to non-Hispanic whites. In a previous slide, I had mentioned that self-report data often underestimate the prevalence of CVD risk factors for racial ethnic minorities. However, in this slide, we see higher rates of CVD risk factors for racial ethnic minorities compared to non-Hispanic whites. Again, it is important to note that these rates may actually be higher than indicated due to underestimation by self-report. I would like to turn the second half of this presentation over to Dr. Latha Palaniappan, who will discuss culturally competent care as well as CVD prevention and treatment recommendations for diverse elders based on their unique CVD risks.
Thank you, Ariel. That was a wonderful presentation. This is the first webinar I've ever done, and I'm definitely missing the audience contact. So I'm going to ask everyone who's on the webinar to go to the top of their screen, and you'll see a person with their hand raised next to the meeting sign on the very top left. And I would love to give all of us to give Ariel some applause. So if you can click the clapping hands when you get there, I'll know that there's actually people on the other end. So I see some people with the hands raised. I don't know if There's a little applause button, too. Oh, yeah, so Bertha got that. If you need me to speak up or speak more softly, you can also use those there. As Chris mentioned earlier, you can also ask us questions as we go along, and we'll be able to answer them at the end. So thank you so much, Ariel, and thank you for that excellent review of the literature. And now we're going to move on to some treatment recommendations. So we're going to first talk about cultural competency, which has become more important of late, and there's lots of federal legislation that orients us towards more patient-oriented care. Actually, I'm going to ask another question right now, and I'm going to ask you to use that raising hand symbol. So if you see patients, can you please raise your hand? So I'm going to do that, too, so you see what that looks like. Okay, so most of the participants look like they do see patients on a daily basis. So that's great. So I'm going to go ahead and direct my comments towards treatment and sort of daily interactions with patients. So cultural competency is very important. There's lack of legislation towards patient-centered care, and cultural competency is part of that. So cultural competency is defined as possessing knowledge, awareness, and respect for other cultures. Sometimes ethnocentrism can get in the way of that. So ethnocentrism is the conviction that one's own culture is superior, and this can hinder effective cross-cultural care. Stereotyping is also something that we want to avoid. So this is making mistaken assumptions about an individual based on group membership. And generalizations, that sounds like stereotyping, but it's slightly different. It means that you're aware of cultural norms. So to give you an example from the Asian Indian culture, which I'm part of, a generalization would be being aware that the festival of Diwali was coming up at the end of October and asking patients, will you be celebrating Diwali? So you make them aware that you're aware of Diwali, but stereotyping would be, oh, are you going to eat all of those sweets that they always have at Diwali? So that would be stereotyping, sort of assuming that the patient is celebrating, and also the assumption that they're celebrating in a bad way. So that's cultural competency. One thing that we can use for our cultural assessment is something called the ASK perspective. So this is awareness, sensitivity, and knowledge. So a cultural assessment at a minimum should ask the following questions. What is the patient's ethnic affiliation? Who are the major support persons and where do they live? With whom should we speak about the patient's health or illness? Because there's definitely, in different cultures, different ideas about who should be involved in the patient's health care. And what are the patient's primary and secondary languages, speaking and reading abilities? And what is the patient's economic situation? So these are all things that Ariel covered with regard to living situation and how that varies across these ethnic groups. So here are some generalizations on this slide about cultural beliefs and CBD. There are various differences with regard to illness beliefs, dietary beliefs, and self-care management. Some things that I'll highlight are that the Western biomedical perspective of, for instance, genes causing abnormal protein, causing disease, is not so prevalent in other cultures, and sometimes supernatural causes come into play, or the idea that this is sort of written in the stars and this disease will happen no matter what the patient does, and a certain sense of fatalism is sometimes apparent. And there's also, in some cultures, a belief that imbalance causes disease. And particularly with regard to diet, there's an East Asian culture, cold and hot foods, and an Asian Indian culture, refraining from spicy foods or dairy is sometimes considered to be helpful. And also look out for self-care management among your racially ethnically diverse elders, because home remedies and treatments are quite common. So the four C's of culture, there's a mnemonic. First, you can ask people, what do you call your problem? So the patient's perception, so a good example with diabetes is sometimes people call it a sugar problem. So what is their perception of it? What do you think caused your problem so you can get at what the patient's beliefs are. Is there a sense of fatalism? Do they feel like they can't change anything about their illness? You can ask them how they cope with their problem. So this gets across the homeopathic and home remedies, such as alternative medicines and treatments. And what are your concerns regarding your condition or recommended treatment? So eliciting the patient's perceptions and fears are important. And this is where you might find out who in their family they would want to know about their illness. So we're going to go over the differential importance of risk factors for CHD, stroke, and peripheral arterial disease. So some of the risk factors are the same, and some are different. So for coronary heart disease, dyslipidemia is a big player, as well as hypertension and diabetes. So behavioral changes that we can do for this are increasing socializing. So we saw in Ariel's slide that Black African-American elders were more likely to live alone, so looking at ways that we can improve socialization in that group would be helpful, because there's research showing that social connections, people with more social connections are likely to have less heart disease. Smoking cessation is also important, diet and physical activity. Stroke, hypertension is the biggest risk factor for stroke, so unlike for CHD where dyslipidemia is more important, hypertension is more important for stroke. So biological risk factor treatment includes antihypertensives, and for behavior change, sodium reduction is recommended. And now the sodium reduction is, we used to have less than 2,000 milligrams of sodium as a recommended sodium dose, but it's actually less than that, less than 1,500 milligrams of sodium. And if your patients are eating any prepared foods, they're likely getting more than that 1,500 milligrams of sodium. So I don't ask so much about how much salt are they using from the salt shaker, but how many times are they opening a can or a bottle for sauces and soups and that type of thing. And for peripheral arterial disease, biological risk factors warrant treatment, including aspirin and antiplatelet therapy, as well as lipid-lowering drugs, which is the same for coronary heart disease. And for behavior change, exercise training and smoking cessation are helpful for peripheral arterial disease. So treatment of dyslipidemia in elderly populations, the main point that I want to make is that there have been studies done in elderly populations, and treatment of dyslipidemia is quite important. Sometimes you have a 70-year-old patient in front of you, and you're wondering whether you really still need to get their LDL in the 100 to 130 range. And the answer is you do. So because a lot of our 70-year-olds are living to 90 and 100, as you know. The one thing that I do recommend is especially if you have patients on multiple medications, to use pravastatin for polypharmacy. Pravastatin is recommended due to kidney as opposed to liver clearance. And the FDA has recommended against simvastatin 80 milligrams for treatment of elderly patients, but other statins have also been supported by clinical trials. There have been no studies of fibrates in the elderly, and there have been no trials performed with niacin in older adults. But the take-home point is, if you have an elderly patient on many drugs, pravastatin is a good first statin to try because it has a different clearance mechanism than the other statins and most other drugs. So that's a good one to start with. It's not as potent a statin as simvastatin and atorvastatin. So the ATP3 guidelines for LDL therapies in older adults. So for primary prevention in the elderly, lifestyle modification, so dietary cholesterol reduction and exercise to reduce triglycerides and raise HDL. Standard risk assessment commonly used in adults, like the Framingham risk score, may not be adequate in older adults, so you should use your clinical judgment. And what most often happens in older adults is that they get so many points on their Framingham risk score because of age that even if their other risk factors are optimized, they still come back with a very high risk. So use your clinical judgment, and Framingham risk score may overestimate risk in this situation. So lipid-lowering therapy should be considered in patients with more than two risk factors or subclinical atherosclerosis. So there's a couple ways that we can measure subclinical atherosclerosis now. One is by carotid intimal-medial thickness, which is sometimes available. Patients will go to these sort of life-spanning things that pop up in churches and that type of thing, and they'll come to you with a carotid intimal thickness scan that they've gotten. The other way to test for subclinical atherosclerosis is to get a coronary artery calcium scan. So this tells us a little bit about the calcification. So if either of those things are positive, lipid-lowering therapy is definitely indicated. And for older adults, similar targets are recommended of less than 130 with two or more risk factors. So there's no difference in treating high cholesterol in elderly patients, and it has been shown to be beneficial, and it lowers mortality. And also for secondary prevention in the elderly, there's no age restrictions. You can treat them at 80 years old, 9 years old, 100 years old, and the target is an LDL-C of less than 100 with known cardiovascular disease or multiple risk factors. So don't be afraid to treat your older patients with statins. Hypertension treatment in the elderly, also recommended. So there have been trials of hypertension in elderly patients, and it is shown to be helpful. It does prevent death. So diagnosis of hypertension, you can get greater than 3 blood pressure measures on 2 separate visits after the patient has rested for 5 minutes, which are elevated. So elevated is over 140 over 90. And you don't really get a lot of secondary hypertension coming up first in elderly patients, but you should definitely identify reversible or treatable causes. So one that would be a little more common in older patients are renal artery stenosis, but you don't often get coarctation of the aorta that's initially discovered in a 60-year-old. Usually that's discovered much younger. So evaluate for organ damage, so check an EKG for LVH, check serum creatinine for kidney damage. And you should assess for other CVD risk factors, including cholesterol and diabetes and other comorbid conditions. And identify barriers to treatment adherence. So one of the big ones is giving an elderly patient a diuretic at night. And so they're getting up all night to urinate, and that's not a very effective thing, especially in men who may also have coexisting prostatic hypertrophy. So look for barriers and try to make the medications work for the patient. So targets in 65 years and older are less than 140 over 90 or less than 150 over 100 if that target is unreachable. So basically, you know, I tell my patients that there's no blood pressure that's too low as long as you're not passing out. So if they can sort of maintain consciousness, then we titrate them to that blood pressure. Sometimes older patients are afraid when their blood pressure is less than 120 over 80, but if they don't have any side effects, that's an okay blood pressure for them. But in contrast, if their blood pressure is 145 over 95 and they're having if they're feeling lightheaded, then you should definitely back down on the medication. For initial medical therapy, thiazide diuretics are recommended, such as hydrochlorothiazide. For older patients, we generally try to prescribe at the lowest dose and increase gradually to achieve target. So even 12.5 of hydrochlorothiazide is not too low to start. And it often takes combination therapy greater than 2 meds to achieve adequate control. So lots of clinical trials have been done, the all-hat trial, and it really does take more than one medication. So don't feel that you failed if you can't get the blood pressure controlled with just one medication. And sometimes just a little bit of 2 medications are nice because they work on different pathways. So I encourage you to try layering sooner rather than later. And considerations in this case are also comorbidities and polypharmacy. And then we're going to have a slide coming up about different pharmacogenomic differences, and we're just still doing more research in this area. But certain patients, particularly Black African American patients with hypertension and CHF, there have been some trials that show that they benefit from specific drugs. So look out for those differences when you're prescribing medications as well. So principles of hypertension treatment, the first step is lifestyle modification. So that includes decreasing the sodium in the diet to less than 1,500 milligrams per day. And ask the patients to look for hidden sodium in sauces and soups and that type of thing. So if they're still not at their target BP, stage 1 hypertension is defined as 140 to 160 over 90 to 100. And stage 2 is greater than 160 over 100. Initial drug choice, as I said before, is thiazide diuretics. And again, many will require greater than 2 medications. And what I wanted to cover in this slide was the compelling indications. So for congestive heart failure, coronary heart disease, or stroke. So for congestive heart failure, you definitely consider thiazide diuretic, beta blockers, and ACE inhibitors for CHD. If you're getting side effects with the ACE inhibitor, definitely start the angiotensin receptor blocker. And calcium channel blockers might also be helpful in CHD and stroke. Post-MI, beta blockers, ACE inhibitors are definitely recommended, aldosterone antagonists, and angiotensin receptor blockers. And with diabetes and chronic kidney disease, ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers for kidney protection are recommended. And the reference is there in case anyone wants to look up more information on that. So here is the promised information on pharmacogenomics and CBD treatment. So the main point is that patients' drug response vary considerably by race ethnicity. So we know that there are differences here. And this can be attributed to differences in the population distribution of genetic polymorphisms that affect drug metabolism or transport or the target of the drug. So I always recommend that you check FDA labels and warnings regarding racial, ethnic, pharmacogenomic differences. And as I said, there's more and more research being done on this daily. So I'm sure even the few examples that we have, there'll be many more coming down the pike, so look out for them. So, for example, I just want to give you a couple examples here. For statins, the FDA label warns that initiation of Crestor therapy with 5 milligrams once daily instead of 10 should be considered for Asian patients. And this is due to a difference in the organic anion transporting polypeptide, so that's OP1B1, and they call this SLO1B1 in Chinese and Japanese. One thing that I'll point out here, which Ariel alluded to before, is the extrapolation. So what I want you to notice is they tested this in Chinese and Japanese patients, and they extrapolated it to all Asian patients. So watch out for this, because what's true in Chinese and Japanese may not be true for Asian Indians and Filipinos, as we'll see for some of these other drugs that we're going to talk about. So warfarin, which is used for anticoagulation, so lower doses of warfarin are recommended for Chinese, Japanese, and Korean patients. However, higher doses are recommended for Black, African Americans, and Asian Indians. And this is due to differences in 2 genes, cytochrome P450, QC9, and vitamin K epoxidase reductase, VCORC1. And clopidogrel Plavix, for Asian patients, Chinese and Japanese patients, at high risk of having genetic, they do have a high risk of a genetic variant that leads to decreased inhibition of platelets. So one thing that I will say about these examples is that for statins and warfarin, you can check a lab to titrate your medication. So for instance, for statins, you can check the LDL. For warfarin, you can check the INR and PT. However, for Plavix, you have your patients post-stent taking Plavix, and you really have no way of knowing whether it's giving them the degree of anticoagulation that you're hoping for. So hopefully we'll have a little bit more guidance on pharmacogenomics in the future, but what I do want you to be aware of is that there are differences, and as a provider, you should be looking out for them. So behavior change, improving a social environment. As Ariel said, social connections are associated with less cardiovascular disease, so the more social connections people have, the less cardiovascular disease they have. And there are race ethnic differences in social connections, so we saw that Black African American elders were more likely to live alone. So why? So diverse elders may not participate in social recreational activities due to language barriers, cultural differences, religious taboos, lack of funding, or transportation. So I'm working on an LGBT, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender website, and one of the things that came up in our discussions about that website are that LGBT elders are not comfortable going to regular senior community centers because they don't feel a sense of community. And what they prefer is going to sort of an LGBT community center across all ages, going to the certain events that they have just for elders, LGBT elders. So try to find places, and it may not be in existing community centers. It could, senior community centers, it could be, for instance, in the Indian Community Center in a part that is for elders. So how do you build a supportive social environment? So identify sources of social support. So asking who lives with them, if they have relatives nearby, who sees them on a regular basis, and provide access to information and services that are culturally and linguistically tailored, and identify barriers to participation and brainstorm solutions. So a couple of resources are listed here, including the Community Partnership for Older Adults, the Community Ambassador Program for Seniors, and Aging Services of California. So for smoking cessation is also recommended for elderly patients. There's no reason to not have them stop smoking. They do still have benefit. So one thing that's confusing to patients is that when they stop smoking, their risk of heart disease immediately goes down, but you still do calculate factors to estimate their risk of cancer. So smoking cessation is definitely helpful at any age. So pharmacotherapy includes nicotine replacement, gum, patches, nasal sprays. These are all effective in different race ethnic populations. Higher doses of pharmacotherapy may be needed for those who smoke menthol cigarettes or within 30 minutes of awakening, even if they're light smokers. And we remember from Ariel's part of the talk that menthol cigarettes are more common in certain race ethnic groups. Black African Americans are more likely to smoke menthol cigarettes. So look for higher doses of pharmacotherapy in those groups. And culturally and linguistically tailored counseling in combination with pharmacotherapy can result in higher cessation rates for diverse populations. So there have been some studies on that. So the cognitive behavioral techniques for diet and physical activity change. So you can use this in your clinical visit with patients. So cultural tailoring involves addressing linguistic and literacy needs. So the American, a couple of resources that I want to mention is that the American Heart Association now on the top right, you can get the information in different languages, including Cantonese, Mandarin, and Vietnamese. So there are some national resources for linguistically tailored information. So in your visit, goal setting is very important, and goals should be specific, measurable, realistic but challenging, and within a certain time frame. So with patients, I might sit down and say, okay, let's have as a goal that you would exercise 3 times a week, and we actually say what specific time of day they might exercise. So it's not just an abstract concept, but something that they can actually operationalize. Self-monitoring is very important. So this helps patients increase awareness of their own behaviors and identify barriers to their own behaviors. So some things that work with elders are handwritten diaries, which my patients sometimes bring in to me. They can also do online logs. And as a provider, you can also send text or email reminders, and I sometimes use, we have an electronic health record where I practice, and I, a week after the visit, will send an email saying, how is that, here are the goals that you discussed, how is it going with the goals? And then the patient can communicate with you, and I do it at the end of the visit and set it so the email sends a week after I see them, so I don't have to remember to do that a week later. Feedback and reinforcement is very important. So in my clinic, I follow people up every 6 weeks because that's the time that it takes for lifestyle changes to show effects in glucose or cholesterol. And then when things are improving, then I see them at 3-month intervals and then 6-month intervals and then annually. You can also do modeling. You can do a cooking class. I have also on occasion, if I have 2 patients with very similar medical problems, have asked each patient, would it be okay if I introduced you to a peer or a buddy that can help you work on your high triglyceride, low HDL problem because I'm recommending some very similar dietary substitutions for you, and maybe you can work together, and that has worked on occasion. And I've also done shared medical appointments where I have 12 patients in a room, all with similar medical conditions, and they can really recommend things to each other, like what brand of bread is good or what yogurt they like and that type of thing, which you as an individual provider may not always be able to do, but you know they can also support each other. Motivational interviewing is a part of cognitive behavioral therapy. It's very individual-centered, so it's the four C's, as we talked about in the beginning with the cultural competencies. And you can explore and resolve ambivalence to change with motivational interviewing. And sometimes patients recognize themselves in the process of vocalizing their barriers, that the barriers may not all be all that hard to overcome. So in problem solving, you identify problems and brainstorm solutions. So I've had patients where they're CEOs and they're on the phone 24/7 because they do business with India and China. So I've actually worked with them to take their conference calls while they're on a treadmill. So there's different things that you can do to fit into each patient's lifestyle. And then care coordination, as I had talked about a little earlier, group interventions. You can also use the team with the nurse-led multidisciplinary team. So in the group medical appointments that I have, I also do that with licensed clinical social workers. And this is, and community involvement is especially important for racial ethnic minorities as well. And it helped to have a member of that community in your care program. So for dietary and physical activity changes specifically, culturally relevant recipes and physical activity recommendations are now available on the American Heart Association website. There's also illustrated nutrition guides available from the Diabetes Prevention Project as well as the American Heart Association. There, you can also provide structured diet assessment and treatment programs through dietitian referral, which I recommend. And having a dietitian follow up with them. So as far as physician involvement, there is some data showing that race-ethnic concordance between the physician and patient are important for improving outcome measures. But as we know, in a very diverse population as we have here, that it's hard to always get that race-ethnic concordance, but this is where the generalizations are helpful. So it's useful to know a little bit about all the cultures that you treat, so you have sort of an opening in the door, but again, be careful with regard to stereotyping. Community resources, as I mentioned, community or senior centers could be helpful, and use of health and community workers like social workers. And several studies have demonstrated that multiple lifestyle changes can be undertaken that lead to significant cardiovascular disease risk reduction in diverse racial ethnic minority groups. So this has been tested in many different race ethnic groups. So I'm going to go over some general recommendations on calorie intake. And one thing that I want to point out is that this is for average, and you really have to take into account height because shorter people obviously have to consume less calories and taller people consume more. So for women ages 50 and older, low physical activity is 1,600 calories a day. And this is where most of our population is, unfortunately, at this low physical activity stage. So patients are sometimes confused because they pick up a package and it says, oh, this nutrition information says I need to consume 2,000 calories a day for a woman. And you're telling me that I need to consume 1,500 and actually I'm about 5'1", and in order to maintain my weight, I have to consume about 1,200 calories a day. So calorie recommendations really need to be personalized, and there's many resources on the web to do that now. For moderately active and active, it gets to be much higher than that. And for men 50 and older, the recommendation is 2,000 calories a day, and sometimes men come in and they think, oh, well, on my cereal box, it says 2,500 calories a day, and but really, as people age, their muscle mass decreases and their resting metabolic rate decreases and their caloric intake should decrease commensurately. So as far as dietary recommendations, We have all heard many vegetables and fruits, and I want to point out here that I put vegetables ahead of fruits because people do tend to overconsume fruits, and especially for people who have diabetes or are at risk of diabetes, fruit contains a lot of sugar. And then there's also a little bit of a smoothie phenomenon going on. People go to the farmer's market, they buy a lot of fruit, they blend it up in their Vitamix, and they think that that's a healthy way to consume fruits. But in fact, what you're doing is breaking down all the fiber that actually modulates your absorption of glucose, and it's basically like drinking sugar water. So I ask them not to blend their fruits, to eat them whole, and to eat more vegetables in general than fruits. And a serving of fruit and vegetable is a half a cup. And I recommend 9 servings of vegetables and fruits, and I break it down to 7 servings of vegetables, 2 servings of fruit a day. And our fruits are very big now. So a banana is actually two servings, because a banana is about 1 cup, and a big apple can be 1 cup. So that's 2 servings. So 1 fruit a day is probably enough, and the rest should be vegetables. And they should aim for half of their total carbohydrates as whole grains. And what I ask people to look for is the amount of fiber in the grain. I ask them to shoot for 3 to 5 grams of fiber per carbohydrate serving as a whole grain. And about 90% of stuff that you see in the grocery store that says whole grain is not actually whole grain. And what I tell people to look for is the fiber. So the fiber has to be high, 3 to 5 grams. So the fiber, what it does is it modulates the absorption of the carbohydrate. So basically it takes it longer to break down. So you get a more mellow absorption of glucose as opposed to that glucose spike. The recommended protein intake is 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight per day. The recommendation is to consume fish, especially oily fish, at least twice a week. And one is to limit intake of saturated fat to less than 7% of total caloric intake and trans fat to less than 1%, and cholesterol to less than 300 milligrams a day. So I ask patients to minimize intake of beverages and foods with added sugars. So I tell my patients to drink nothing but water and non-fat milk. So no juice. People think juice is quite healthy, but really it has lots of calories and it's very processed. And then again, the sodium recommendation is less than 1,500 milligrams per day for patients less than 50 years old. And goes down to less than 1,200 milligrams a day for greater than 70 years old. And it is very hard to hit that when you eat prepared food. So if your patients are eating any prepared food, so and especially those who live alone, so they're buying the cans of Campbell's and the prepared tomato sauce and that type of thing, and if you're eating 2 things of prepared food, you've already exceeded the 1,200 milligrams. So watch out for that. And if your patients do consume alcohol, the recommendation is to do so in moderation. And for women, this is defined as 1 drink per day. And for men, this is 2 drinks per day. And sometimes patients ask me, well, can I drink all 7 drinks on Saturday? And that's not healthy, considered binge drinking. So moderate intake is sort of on a daily basis. Okay. And I do see the questions coming through, and I'll get to them all at the end. So thank you for asking questions. It makes me feel like there are people on the other end, so that's great. So physical activity guidelines for ages 65 and older. The recommendation is for 150 minutes, 2 hours and 30 minutes a week of moderate intensity, or 75 minutes a week of vigorous intensity aerobic physical activity, or an equivalent combination. And this can be done in episodes of at least 10 minutes. So people sometimes get upset that they have to do an hour a day of physical activity, but you can tell them they can do it in 10-minute bouts 6 times a day. So even for people who work, they can do, if they have a 15-minute break in the morning, they do 10 minutes then, maybe 20 minutes at lunch, 10 minutes in the afternoon, and then some time before they go to work or after. So they can break it up. So that's helpful. Sometimes people are a little confused about what moderate intensity is and what vigorous intensity is. So the actual formula is 220 minus the person's age gives you what the maximum target heart rate is. So for moderate intensity, they want to be at 50 to 70% of their maximum target heart rate. And for vigorous, they want to be at 70 to 85% of their maximum target heart rate. And you have to remember that this formula is really affected by age. So let me give you an example. So for a 50-year-old person, you do 220 minus age, and you get 170 is the max heart rate. So 50% of that max heart rate is 85 beats per minute, and 70% of that max heart rate is 119. So you can tell your 50-year-old patient who's taken a walk that they need to hit their heart rate between 85 and 120. And for someone who's older, like an 80-year-old person who's maybe trying to do vigorous exercise, so you do 220 minus 80, which is 140. So their max heart rate is a lot less because their age is so much more. So 70% of that is 140 times 0.7, that's about 98, and 140 times 0.85 is about 120. So their, for vigorous exercise, is 100 to 120. So what I want to stress is that those heart rates don't sound so high. In contrast to taking a 20-year-old person who's vigorously exercising, and their heart rate is 170. So sometimes patients come and they say, my heart rate isn't getting up that high, even though I'm working out as hard. But as you age, your heart rate is not going to get that high, and you don't need to achieve very high heart rates. Another way is this perceived exertion scale. It's a 20-point scale. It's called the BORG exertion scale, and it's 0 to 20. And so for your older patients, you want them around, 10 to 15. So you don't want them to get up too high. And on the BORG scale, basically, you multiply that by 10, it approximates their heart rate a little bit. So, and patients are very confused about this, and I was just reading a study today that it's much better to demonstrate it to them, what moderate intensity is and vigorous intensity, because if you just tell them, well, moderate intensity means that you can carry out a conversation but you can't sing, and vigorous intensity means that, you can speak one word, one or two words, it's a little bit sort of harder for patients to interpret. So if you are in a position to be able to demonstrate that, I think that's helpful, though it is difficult in the clinical room. One thing I want to point out is that in 2006, strength training has been added to the recommendation. So when I went to medical school, strength training was not part of it. We just said aerobic activity, 30 minutes, most days of the week. But now strength training is very important because we have lots of research that it's great for bone strength. So you decrease osteoporosis with strength training. And it's also very good for diabetes and increasing muscle mass and increasing resting metabolic rate. So strength training is recommended at moderate or high intensity, greater than 2 days a week, and it should involve all major muscle groups. And you should do 10 to 15 repetitions per exercise. And I usually ask patients, at least at the beginning, to work out with a personal trainer or have someone teach them how to do strength training, because otherwise they come back with a musculoskeletal injury, and then we're even worse than when we started. Balance activities are also important, 3 times a week, and for a total of 90 minutes a week, so 30 minutes, 3 times a week. And you can combine the balance with the strength training. And balance is very important for preventing falls, which is something that we need to worry about in our older patients. And, you add this up, and patients really do have to spend sort of an hour and a half a day sort of to meet all these physical activity recommendations. So they do have to focus more on this. So weight management in the elderly, we find that the relative risk of morbidity and mortality among overweight and obese older adults is lower than for middle-aged adults. So, what I say is that we don't strictly have to get people to that BMI of 25, which is considered normal. So actually, if you look at the mortality curves, even 26 or 27 is okay. But I think that almost all data suggests that getting people out of obesity and at least into that overweight range is definitely helpful, and close to 26, 27, that those would all be good goals. And I'll remind us that only 1/3 of the U.S. is at normal weight, 1/3 is overweight, and 1/3 is obese. So 2 out of every 3 patients that are walking into your clinic probably need to lose weight. And as we said, that there are age-related changes in body composition, so there's less lean muscle mass, more fat as we age. And also there was a great article in the Wall Street Journal a few days ago that nicely showed that there's also losses in height as we age. So BMI changes as we get older. And waist circumference cut points may also be useful. So abdominal adiposity is more harmful. And obesity treatment should be based on potential benefits for weight reduction for day-to-day functioning. So I tell patients that if they lose weight, it's easier on their hips, it's easier on their knees, so it's easier on their joints and for osteoarthritis. There's a reduction in future cardiovascular events. And also it helps with depression and just overall well-being. So I try to emphasize the multifactorial effects of weight loss and exercise. So a reduction of 500 to 750 kilocalories a day results to 1 to 1.5 pounds of weight loss per week. So it's about 3,500 calories per pound. Recommendations for macronutrient composition are quite wide. So it can be up to 15 to 30% protein. But I actually recommend for your older patients, because they are getting this loss of muscle mass, to maybe emphasize protein a little bit more to build up muscle mass. And as we age, 40 to 60% carbohydrates and 25 to 30% fat. As I said, the higher protein intake, 1 to 1.2 grams per kilogram per day, as opposed to the 0.8, which is recommended for just adults. And then making sure that they still get the key nutrients, which if they're eating the required amounts of fruits and vegetables, they generally do. Getting the adequate amounts of vitamin D, B12, fiber is very important. So if they eat the whole complex carbohydrates, they're getting adequate amounts of fiber. And fluids, it's about 8 glasses a day, 8 to 10 glasses a day for women and up to 12 glasses a day for men. So fluids are very important. And as I said, not juice, water, non-fat milk, and the glass of wine if they're doing that. And as I mentioned before, strength training is especially important to reduce sarcopenia in older adults. So remind your patients that strength training is now part of the physical activity recommendation. So here we have a long list of resources for patients and providers, so I'll let you go through that. I mentioned a little bit about the American Heart Association. They have stuff in English and Spanish, as I've mentioned, other languages as well. You can go to their website and take a look. NHLBI has information for different groups, USDA, and there's a specific website for American Indians. The National Institute on Aging has information in English and Spanish. There's also continuing education and community resources. And then I just want to point out that there's much more literature now on cultural diversity in healthcare and resources to address our diverse populations. I'm going to put in a little plug for the website that we've created here at the Palo Alto Medical Foundation, specifically for South Asian patients. So the URL is here, and that's a screenshot of the title page. And we have some videos that kind of talk about why South Asians are at risk and some of the fun things to go over to improve your own cultural competency in this area is this common Indian myths, which are explored. And then we should also be aware that for Asians, different body mass index cut points are recommended by the World Health Organization. So for all Asians, not just South Asians, so Chinese, Japanese, Vietnamese, Korean, Filipino, and South Asians, BMI less than 23 is recommended because, as Ariel said, they have higher risk of diabetes at lower body weight. And with that, I'm going to thank you. And as Chris mentioned, you can contact the Stanford Geriatric Education Center if you'd like to contact us, but our contact information is here, so feel free to send us an email. So thank you. And with that, I'm going to start addressing some of these questions. So the first question was from Christine Wagon, and it says, would you clarify if the BP target is less than 130 over 65 is to be avoided, as this is what the slide said, if no signs and symptoms of lightheadedness, syncope, et cetera. So So to clarify that, yeah, the BP target is less than 130 over 65, but sometimes patients get worried if, for instance, their blood pressure is over 140 over 90 and you put them on a little hydrochlorothiazide and they come back and their blood pressure is 118 over 68 and they have no symptoms. I probably wouldn't titrate the hydrochlorothiazide down to get up to 130 over 65. So if they're fine with the 118 over 68 and they don't have any symptoms, you don't need to hit the 130 over 65 exactly. But again, don't push too low if the patient isn't tolerating it, if they have symptoms of lightheadedness or syncope. So sorry that wasn't more clear. And Christine, if you could just type in if that answered your question or not, that would help me. And I'm going to move on to Keisha's question. And the question was, how do you get people to attend your group visits? And Keisha, we have a program at Palos Medical Foundation. It's called Shared Medical Appointment. And what we do is, well, there's a couple of different ways to do it. You can ask patients from your own practice to attend a shared medical appointment. So, for instance, in Los Altos, there was a doctor who had her own practice but felt that sort of the 10-minute visits weren't enough to do diet and exercise counseling with her patients. So she would tell her patient, I'd like you to come see me at a shared medical appointment, which I have on Thursday afternoons for an hour and a half, so please drop in whenever you get a chance. So we actually published in the Journal of the American Board of Family Practice, and if you just Google Journal American Board of Family Practice and my last name, it'll come up. But we found that patients who went to these shared medical appointments for weight loss actually did better than people who were in her own practice. So this having an hour and a half of diet and exercise counseling and getting that crosstalk between patients was more effective for weight loss than just the 10-minute individual appointment. So in this case, the doctor self-referred to her own SMA. The way that I do shared medical appointments, so I did shared medical appointments specifically for South Asian patients, and doctors, other primary care doctors who have South Asian patients referred to this SMA. So you can either have it as a referral or consultation service, or you can do it as part of your own practice. So that was the end of that question. So Keisha, if you could just let me know that it, if that answered your question, that would be helpful. And Christine, I see that the blood pressure question was answered. So thank you for your questions. And if anyone has anything else, please let me know.
This is Ariel. I just wanted to say that I shared a link to the Shared Medical Appointments article on the PAMF website if anyone's interested in checking that out.
Thank you, Ariel.
This is Christopher Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on cardiovascular disease. I'd like to thank the presenters, Dr. Latha Palaniappan and Ms. Holland. Thank you very, very much. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, October 6th, 12:30 p.m. Pacific Time. It will be on Dementia Assessment and Family Caregiving Part 1 Latino and presented by Drs. Melissa Talamantes and Liliana Oakes. Thank you so much for your participation.